Drugs versus lifestyle is always a big debate, and people have very strong feelings about it. But scientific studies and clinical trials rarely compare the two head to head. But a recent trial did exactly that. They took about 400 people with a recent diagnosis of type 2 diabetes, and everybody got the usual healthy diet and exercise advice that you give to anyone with diabetes. And then they split all the participants randomly into three groups. One group received a diabetes drug called metformin, pretty usual regimen, half a gram twice a day initially, and then if people do well on it, they up it to 2 grams a day. And what metformin does physiologically is it reduces glucose production in the liver, so it helps lower glucose levels in people with diabetes, and it also suppresses appetite, so it helps with weight loss. The second group received a different diabetes drug called empagliflozin, 10 milligrams a day, and empagliflozin also reduces glycemia, but through a different mechanism. It stimulates the excretion of glucose by the kidney, and it also helps with weight loss. And then the third group was put on a dietary regimen, specifically this type of fasting or caloric restriction called 5-2. And the way they did it, 5-2, every week the participants had 2 non-consecutive days where they cut calories a lot. They basically got a meal replacement product. It's essentially a powder that you add to water and you make a shake. So that replaces a meal. So they had that 3 times a day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So in those fasting days or caloric restriction days, in addition to those 3 shakes, the participants were allowed to add a few foods, things like vegetables, fruit, or an egg, for example. So the total number of calories they were getting on those 2 days was between 500 and 600 calories a day, which is pretty low. It's about 25% of the calories you would normally eat on a given day. On the other 5 days of the week, they had a normal or closer to normal diet. For breakfast and for lunch, they would have their usual choice, the same as before the trial. And then for dinner, they also got one of these meal replacement shakes together with a few other foods. So the shake was supposed to replace some of their regular dinner, not all. So that was basically the trial, these 3 groups. After 4 months of this intervention, all groups benefited compared to baseline, but the 5-2 group was better at improving a number of metrics. Weight loss, they lost almost twice as much weight on 5-2 as they did on the drugs. On either of the drug groups, the participants lost about 5 to 6 kilos, whereas on 5-2, they lost almost 10 kilos, so pretty substantial difference. And accordingly, their BMI and their waist circumference, so these body metrics, were reduced in all groups, but more so on 5-2. And then the main thing they were looking at, the primary outcome, was hemoglobin A1C. So this glycated hemoglobin measurement, again, lowered on all groups, but more so more strongly on 5-2. A couple other metrics like blood pressure and triglycerides, same pattern, improved on all groups, but more strongly on 5-2. When it came to fasting glucose, it came down in all 3 groups. There was no significant difference between the 3 groups when looking at all the participants combined. But when the investigators looked only at the completers, only the participants that had finished the trial, then they did see a significant difference with 5-2 again, being stronger, lowering fasting glucose more. And finally, uric acid levels. When the investigators looked at completers, so participants that had finished the trial, uric acid was lower on 5-2 than on metformin, but it was lowest on empagliflozin. Then the investigators took a closer look at hemoglobin A1C, and they wanted to find out what percentage of patients were no longer technically diabetic by the end of the trial. So the cutoff for hemoglobin A1C, for glycated hemoglobin, to consider someone diabetic is 6.5%. So what percentage of patients in each group were below that cutoff? And they found that 55% of the participants on empagliflozin had achieved remission, 60% of the metformin patients, and 80% of the patients on 5-2. And even 2 months past the end of the trial, they went back and measured again just to see kind of how sustainable these changes were. And 77% of participants that had been on 5-2 during the trial were still under this cutoff, and so technically not diabetic anymore. So pretty good sustainability, at least in this time frame. This is interesting because in a recent video, we looked at another trial that also used 5-2 as an approach to diabetes, so a population also of participants with type 2 diabetes, and they reported that 20% roughly of participants were in remission by the end of the trial. So why this difference? Why 20% in one trial and 80% in this one when they both use seemingly the same approach, 5-2? Well, in this trial, they cut calories more. The calorie target was lower. They lost substantially more weight, and their hemoglobin A1C went down more as well. So it kind of makes sense, and it's interesting because in nutrition, we often talk about these labels. We call things, oh, these people are fasting, or these people are doing low fat or low carb. But of course, what ultimately matters, what our body cares about, are the specifics. What is actually going on? How many calories are actually going in? What foods are actually going in? What nutrients, right? Rather than these labels. So we always have to remind ourselves of that and look at the actual details. A couple other metrics like LDL cholesterol and insulin resistance using the HOMA-IR model seem to be improved in all groups, or at least trending towards improvement, but no significant difference between the groups. The investigators also looked at side effects, adverse effects of the interventions, and the most common one was hypoglycemia, so sugar levels being too low. This happened in about 4-5% of participants in all three groups. So this is one reason I always recommend that people with type 2 diabetes who are doing these interventions, either getting on a new drug or doing a substantial dietary regime, changing their diet substantially, always do this, work with your doctor, so that you can keep an eye on these metrics and avoid these hypoglycemic episodes. Another common side effect was gastrointestinal symptoms, and that was seen specifically in the participants taking metformin, not so much on empagliflozin or the 5-2 folks. So 5-2 actually looked pretty safe. The one concern was hypoglycemia, which is common to all three interventions. Now, on that previous video with the other trial, a lot of you guys asked a very intelligent question. Is hemoglobin A1C being lower kind of artificial? Is this happening just because these people are fasting, these people are cutting their calories, so they're eating less, so their glucose is going to be elevated less? Is that all that's going on, or is there an actual metabolic improvement? In other words, are they still diabetic, but their glucose just isn't spiked as much because they're eating less, so it's kind of masked? Or did they actually improve their metabolism so that it's no longer diabetic? This is a great question, and my answer for this trial is very similar to what it was for the previous trial. I suspect there is a metabolic improvement because other metrics other than hemoglobin A1C also corroborate this. So fasting glucose, for example, as we said, in the completers, in the participants that actually finished the trial, fasting glucose was reduced in all three groups and more so on 5-2. So that can't be as easily explained by less eating, less glucose spikes, because fasting glucose is more a function of hepatic insulin resistance and how much intrahepatic triglyceride there is. And then the results with weight loss also align with this. Weight loss in all three groups, more so on 5-2. So it kind of aligns with this idea that there is an overall metabolic improvement that is delivered by this dietary regime. It's interesting that HOMA-IR was not significantly different between the three groups. So looking at kind of a general measure of insulin resistance, it was lower on 5-2 compared to baseline, but it also seemed to trend down in the two drug groups. So overall, it didn't reach statistical significance comparing across the three groups. So that's an interesting observation. Unclear if it's just statistical power or maybe over a longer time frame, maybe it would reach statistical significance. But overall, I think there is evidence there that there is a metabolic improvement beyond just less glucose spikes. So I think the point, the takeaway from this trial is not to shame people who are on diabetes meds and who are doing well on them. We're not all the same. We're not all built the same. But I think this emphasizes the power, the potential of lifestyle. Lifestyle should always be tried first. We go to medication in the cases where lifestyle is not enough. And we have an epidemic of type 2 diabetes. And if people knew that tweaking their diet, cutting calories a bit, 2 days a week could solve their problem, not everybody would. Not 100% of people would be successful or be willing to do it. But millions of people would. So we need to get this information out there a lot more and a lot better than we are. What if you don't like fasting? Or maybe you've tried it and it didn't work for you. As we've said here before, there's nothing magical about fasting. It's a useful tool to control the calories, but there's other approaches that can also help you put diabetes in remission and achieve healthy body weight. We covered everything you need to know about putting diabetes in remission in this previous video right here. And here's one about exercise and diabetes. What are the best workouts? Check those out. I'll meet you over there. Take care.